Along the western bank of the Mississippi River, you'll find St. Louis, Missouri. The city is probably best known for its giant gateway arch. It's a monument that stands tall to recognize the city as the gateway to the west. It was also the birthplace of Christian Taylor Ferguson. Christian was born on October 9, 1993, to 19-year-old Dawan Taylor and 20-year-old Theda Person. He slipped into a coma a few days after birth and almost died. Doctors worked on him around the clock and finally figured out that he had a rare genetic disorder called citrullinemia. It can cause toxic levels of ammonia to accumulate in the bloodstream, leading to a coma, brain damage, and even death. He was given medication and awoke from his coma after 3 days, acting as a regular baby boy does. Despite this diagnosis, Christian could still live as close to normal as possible if he took his medicine and followed his dietary restrictions. His parents had to undergo rigorous training to care for their son correctly. Theda and Dawan were allowed to take him home when their training was complete and Christian was well enough. It was around this time that Theda began pushing for marriage. The young couple had met in high school and were in college when she became pregnant but were not married. Because of her Christian background, Theda felt incredibly guilty for having a child out of wedlock. She thought her decision to have sex before marriage may have resulted in God punishing her by making Christian sick. They would marry 4 months after Christian's birth and have another son named Connor on Valentine's Day of 1994. When Christian was 3 years old, his parents decided to divorce. Hatred had been building between them for months leading up to the split, and the divorce would be bitter. After multiple battles in court, Dawan was granted custody of his two sons. Theda would contest the court's decision numerous times. In January of 2001, when Christian was 7 years old, Dawan rushed into the hospital. He had found the boy unconscious in bed and soaked in vomit. When he arrived at the hospital, Christian suffered a significant seizure that lasted longer than 3 minutes. He slipped into another coma that lasted almost a month. When he awoke in February, doctors discovered that he had sustained severe brain damage, which left him disabled. He had to relearn how to walk, had to wear a diaper, couldn't speak or swallow, and had a feeding tube implanted. The tension between Dawan and Theda had started to loosen, so Theda was allowed to take the boys on supervised visits. In March of 2003, Christian's case was reviewed by the Department of Health and Services. Because Dawan hadn't signed Christian up for school as the DHS specified, he lost his nursing benefits. Nurses had been coming to the house since Christian became disabled. Now Dawan would be on his own to care for Christian. In early April 2003, on one visit with her boys, Theda smelled ammonia and saw signs of neglect to Christian. She took him to the hospital and wasn't allowed visitation for several weeks afterward by Dawan. Theda petitioned the court to gain full custody of her children. Both parents stood before a judge in early June, and Dawan was ordered to allow Theda visitation or be held in contempt. The follow-up court appearance was scheduled for a week later on June 14th. However, on the morning of June 11th, 2003, Dawan called 911 saying that his car had been stolen and his disabled 9-year-old son Christian was in the back seat. Investigators were immediately concerned because they knew Christian couldn't survive more than 72 hours without his medication. Dawan told investigators he was taking Christian to the hospital after discovering that the child had been vomiting throughout the night. He said Christian was only wearing a diaper, so he wrapped him in a blanket and placed him in the back of his maroon 1998 Ford Expedition. Ferguson then began to drive to the hospital around 6 a.m. and got out of his car to call the emergency unit to let them know he was outside. Dawan said he walked about 100 yards to a small strip of stores on Page Boulevard to find a payphone to make that call, leaving the keys in the ignition with the car running. Once he got to the phone, he noticed his car driving away, heading east, but didn't get a good look at the driver, so he could not provide a description to investigators. The police launched a massive search with all hands on deck, including multiple police municipalities and medical facilities. The media quickly ran stories about the theft and abduction on television and radio. Theda found out about her son's disappearance through a news broadcast. Within 2 hours of Christian being reported as abducted, the Ferguson Police Department received a call about the truck's location. The man said he saw an abandoned SUV at the end of a cul-de-sac where the road meets two train tracks. The location of the SUV was approximately 5 miles away from the payphone that Dawan had used to call 911. An officer was dispatched to the truck's location and found it unlocked with the keys still in the ignition. There were no signs of Christian. Tracker dogs were then brought in to track Christian's scent, but they couldn't pick up on anything. Investigators began knocking on the doors of residents in the area and searched the woods and train tracks for clues. They were unable to find any traces of Christian. After thoroughly examining the SUV, police became suspicious of Dawan's story. Two cell phones, a laptop, a digital camera, and a bulletproof vest were found. They wondered why a thief would leave so many valuable items in a car if the purpose were theft. Another glaring point of contention for the detectives was that those two cell phones found in the vehicle were in perfect working condition. Dawan wouldn't have needed to use a payphone to call the hospital. Once the payphone's records came back, it showed no outgoing call to the hospital that morning. The detectives asked Dawan to take a polygraph test, but he declined and asked to speak with an attorney. Dawan's new wife, Monica, her two daughters, and his other son, Connor, were questioned about him leaving at 6 a.m. His wife stated that she had heard him come home from work around 11 p.m. but fell asleep and didn't hear anything about Christian till he contacted her after the 911 call. Her 16-year-old daughter stated that she remembered Dawan leaving the house with Christian around 4 a.m. Connor said his dad came into the room during the night and took Christian with him but said it was very dark outside. The detectives checked the official weather report for that day, showing the sun rose between 5:30 a.m. and 6 a.m. with an early twilight at 5:04 a.m. Also, the distance from Dawan's house to the payphone was only 1.96 miles away, and the 911 call did not come in until 6:09 a.m. Police asked Monica if Dawan knew anyone who lived in the town of Ferguson. Monica told them about their friend Lakeisha Mays. She said they were all close friends and their children sometimes played together. Detectives went to Lakeisha's house to speak with her about Christian's disappearance. When they arrived, they noticed her driveway was empty and asked if she had a car. She told them she had a gold 1998 Chevrolet Malibu sedan. The officers asked where it was and she said she didn't know. She explained that her mother, Monica, and Dawan all had keys to the vehicle and would sometimes use it. They would, however, usually leave her a message, and this time there was no message. May's vehicle was located at 4:38 p.m. parked less than 100 yards from the payphone Dawan said he had used to report the abduction. Throughout the next few months, investigators continued working on the leads, but the prosecutor's office said they did not have enough physical evidence to prosecute the case. Authorities learned that Dawan and Monica had moved out of their home within a month and a half of Christian's disappearance. They went to the new owner, who hadn't touched the property since the purchase, and asked if they could thoroughly search the home. She agreed and signed a consent form. On August 12th and 13th, 2003, the St. Louis Police Department, with the assistance of the FBI Evidence Response Team, searched the old Ferguson home. The couple had left many items behind, including a gastrostomy tube similar to the one implanted in Christian's body. The tube had blood and other bodily fluids on it. Marks were discovered on the end that is surgically implanted in the body, believed to be from some tool. It appeared like the device had been forcibly removed from someone. They also found medication showing that Christian's prescriptions hadn't been filled since April 2003, and there was far too much medicine left for him to have been adequately medicated at the time of his disappearance. Further investigations into his pharmaceutical records showed 2 to 5 month periods where a 30-day supply of medicine hadn't been filled. In another conversation police had with Connor, the boy told them that on Monday, June 9th, 2003, he noticed Christian's G-tube was missing. Connor said he saw dry blood around where it would go into Christian, so he looked for it but could not find it. The day before Christian went missing, Connor said that Christian had been very sick and had been moaning throughout the afternoon. So he told his stepmother Monica, who allegedly responded that she knew all about it and to stay out of Christian's room, and then went back to ironing. Connor then explained that he went to check on Christian, who was lying flat on his back, not making a sound. He stated all he could see were the whites of Christian's eyes. The police now believe that the feeding tube had been removed from Christian. Then over the next 48 hours leading up to June 11th, he died and was reported missing. It was hypothesized that Dawan came home and found Christian dead. Then at approximately 4 a.m., removed Christian from the home and disposed of his body in an undisclosed location. They believe he then drove his SUV to the cul-de-sac where it was later found. Then at approximately 5 a.m., Dawan walked less than a mile to the resident of Lakeisha Mays and used his spare key to take the vehicle. He later parked that car 100 yards from the payphone on a side street, walked to the phone, dialed 911, and reported his son's fabricated abduction. Even with all the suspicion leaning in the direction of Dawan, no charges were filed against him for 16 years. But on October 3, 2019, Dawan Ferguson was officially charged with the murder of Christian Ferguson and child abuse leading to his death. All the evidence against him was laid out in the same timeline as stated above. The prosecution brought out witness after witness that discussed the neglect and the care he showed against Christian. The defense tried hard to explain the car thief theory to the jury, but with all the circumstantial evidence surrounding the case, they didn't buy it. Dawan didn't take the stand. On July 1, 2022, Dawan Ferguson was convicted of first-degree murder in the death of his 9-year-old son, Christian Ferguson, whose body has never been found as of this recording. He is facing life in prison. To add more to this story, on August 3, 2022, Dawan Ferguson was convicted of 5 sex crimes against children in a St. Louis County Circuit Court. One of the 2 victims in the case became pregnant when she was 13 and had Ferguson's child. Ferguson took the stand in his own defense, telling jurors the child found a used condom and used it to impregnate herself. The charges he was convicted of are tied to incidents that happened in 2000, 2008, and 2010. He will be sentenced on the child sexual assault charges on September 16th. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below.